Hello, everybody. I figured I'd better jump on before I drown in the technical difficulties, which is why I wasn't on the chat just now. I actually can't go on the chat right now. My computer crashed twice in the course of setting up the show today, so maybe that means it'll be a good show. Anyway, so I better just launch in. I'm really excited, about the series because, basically, it's the same blue pill, red pill situation all over again that our culture has been brainwashing us into thinking there's a choice between looking at evidence and being rational and being reasonable, or believing in God, or even taking very, very, very seriously the Catholic faith as revealed truth and absolutely true, absolute truth, perfect truth. That somehow it's irrational to do so. So today's show, as you know, the last couple of shows have been on evolution because to clear the terrain, I wanted to clear out the blue pill, so to speak, the myth of evolution. Let me pull up that theme slide for the series. There you have the blue pill and the red pill. I keep forgetting the guy's name, but anyways, from the movie The Matrix. And one of my main, I don't know if heroes is the right word, but one of the icons of this entire series is G.K. Chesterton, this entire series being Science and Faith, because he did a wonderful job of discussing science and faith. So I want to start, I guess, the show with another beautiful quote of his. It's actually a paraphrase. I couldn't find the exact quote. But I'll just read it. G.K. Chesterton, I am asked as a purely intellectual question why I believe in the Catholic faith. It should be when I am asked as a purely intellectual question why I believe in the Catholic faith. I can only answer, I believe in it quite rationally upon the evidence. And again, I've used this quote in a previous show, but the believers in miracles accept them, rightly or wrongly, because they have evidence for them. The disbelievers in miracles deny them rightly or wrongly because they have a doctrine against them. And let me see if I can quickly find the final one here. Again, Chesterton, that's a picture of him on the left. If it comes to human testimony, there is a choking cataract of human testimony in favor of the supernatural. If you reject it, you can only mean one of two things. You either deny that the testimony of ordinary people is to be believed, or you affirm the main principle of materialism, the abstract impossibility of miracle. You have the perfect right to do so, but in that case, you are the dogmatist. It is we Christians who accept all actual evidence. It is you rationalists who refuse actual evidence, being constrained to do so by your creed. So you can see... let me pull myself up here. You can see why I'm starting with these quotes. This is actually, in some sense, the theme of the entire series, Science and Faith, and even more so, it is specifically the theme of today's episode, which is going to the first module in today's episode, so to speak, is going to introduce the philosophical errors that are behind this dogma of strict materialism, and a little of the psychology of how it came about. And then, to the extent that time permits, we will go on to some extremely compelling evidences of miracles. I'm going to use the medical miracles at Lourdes as the primary example. And also, I want to contrast to a beautiful story, contrast two individuals who went to Lourdes and had opposite responses. Emile Zola, who went and saw proof of the miracles. He was, of course, I shouldn't say of course, but he was a fallen away Catholic, I presume. He was a Frenchman. And he saw the miracles. He saw very dramatic miracles. And he refused to believe in them and lied about them afterwards. And Franz Werfel, who was a non-believing Jew who went to Lourdes, but he his heart was open, and he was, he was converted by what he saw and by what he felt, and he ended up writing the Song of Bernadette. I think most of you know the movie, if not the novel, The Song of Bernadette, but basically made Lourdes much more widely known in actually around the world from that, and ended up in the Catholic faith. So anyway, that's today's show. That's kind of the table of contents for today's show. So let me get into it. Okay, I'm going to back up a step. And the first question is, or the first issue, is to look at what we're talking about when we talk about culture. I've used the word Zeitgeist in the past on the show. Zeitgeist being German for spirit of the times. I'm stirring the two together. Culture, spirit of the times, the prevalent worldview in a given culture, in a given society, and so forth. So what's this business about culture or zeitgeist? Okay, starting with the very foundation, life on earth. What is the meaning of life? Life on earth is about the battle for human souls between God and the enemy, period. That's what creation is for. God created everything. He created the entire world in order to be able to create immortal human souls to be with him forever in heaven. Life on earth is just, I mean, earth is simply the battleground for this battle between Satan, who wants the destruction of human souls, their damnation, and God, who wants them to be with him in heaven. That's what the battle is, the chips of that battle, so to speak, the victory tokens of that battle, or the objects of that battle, are the human souls themselves. And it's culture, it's our culture that defines the battleground, the context for the individual battles, which are fought out in every human soul. So each of us as individuals, we're fighting for our own salvation, let's hope. But so that's our battle. That's us standing there with our sword and our shield or whatever, fighting to save our souls. But it takes place on a battleground, right? And that battleground is the culture. And, you know, you can be standing uphill trying to fight an enemy who's got a position of superiority because he's above you, because he's above you on the hill. Or you can be kind of fighting down to somebody below you. Or you can be fighting in thick mud or whatever, in a heavy rainstorm, or you can be fighting in good conditions and so forth. The fight's up to you, but the battleground can make it a whole lot easier or a whole lot harder. And that battleground is the culture or the zeitgeist. Some cultures make God's job easier, that of saving souls, make our jobs easier of getting to heaven. For instance, cultures that promote and support religion, beauty, peace. The effect of natural beauty is incredible on the human soul. A lot of my conversion took place in the Austrian Alps. I was just there to go skiing. But I'll never forget one afternoon, it was about sunset. I'm at the top of the mountain. I'm about to take my last run down the mountain. It's above the tree line. It's very high Alps. And all of the snow, it's called the blue hour in French. The sun, I guess, had dropped below the horizon. All of the snow on all of these like endless mountains and snowfields was blue. The sky was a beautiful pinkish red. I just looked out. I was an atheist, but I looked out and something in my soul said, there must be a God. You know, natural beauty lifts the soul to God. Man-made beauty lifts the soul to God. Great art, music. That's one reason I try to play good music on this show. You know, if you listen to gangster rap, you know, it's going to draw your soul down into hell. If you listen to, you know, the right kind of music, Gregorian chant or Mahler or Beethoven or whatever, something's going to penetrate your soul and lift it up. So some cultures make God's job easier, so to speak. And there's the opposite. That's also true. Some cultures make it an uphill battle in some sense for God to save souls or for us to save our own souls. Imagine a culture that embraces human slavery, that embraces polygamy, that embraces child marriage, where a girl as young as six can be married to, you know, a 60-year-old man, where art and music is actually forbidden, where essentially culture and art are history are forbidden, where women are actually chattel, are like possessed animals, possessed by the owner, that is, and so forth. And of course, somebody born and living in that culture, it's going to be a tremendously uphill battle for him to save his soul. And I think many of you, I hope, recognize the culture that I'm describing, because in fact, I think we all know that in Islam, human slavery is not only permitted, it was actually practiced by Muhammad himself, and it's legal and practiced, you know, throughout the Islamic world. In some countries, it's practiced without being legal. In some countries, it's practiced while being legal. Polygamy is practiced and legal. Child marriage is practiced and legal, all because on the basis that Muhammad himself engaged in them. And it would be blasphemy to make illegal anything that Muhammad engaged in, because he was the perfect model of man and of man's ideal behavior. And music is strictly forbidden. So just imagine the uphillness of that battle to save souls, so to speak. So that is why it is so important to look consciously at our culture and our zeitgeist, because it's basically because it's driving souls to hell. Not literally, because everyone has free will, but it's making it much, much harder for individual souls to be saved. So again, this is a reason to take the red pill. Here we go again. To take the red pill and not the blue pill. And this is also the reason why I spend so much time on evolution, because evolution is, of course, part of the zeitgeist, that we can't look at creation and see it as evidence of God existing, because we know that it was impersonally produced by random mutation and lucky accidents and a survival of the fittest and so forth. So, okay, so where did this come from? Our current zeitgeist, which basically says, if you're going to believe in God, much worse, believe in the Catholic faith, you have to check your mind at the door. Okay, so I'm just going to look back a little bit historically at where this came from. So just think of the world about 200 years ago, okay? Everything in our current luxurious, comfortable society, actually, most of it comes from science. That if you imagine 200 years ago, there was no real transportation except horse and wagon. There was no electricity. There was no communication except, of course, written letters carried by horses and stagecoaches. No plumbing, no medicine to speak of, no conveniences, needless to say, no machinery. It was a much harder world to live in. Everything, physically speaking, spiritually, was probably a much easier world to live in. But anyway, all of the advantages we have today, all of the luxuries and comforts, has come essentially through science, to which we should all be very grateful, to advancement in knowledge and technology. So I think the error is in part that since we owe so much to science, the word science has almost become synonymous with good, that anything that has to do with science is good, anything that doesn't have to do with science is bad. Science is a word for the good, for our advancement, for our civilization itself. In a way, there's nothing wrong with that if people would be honest about what constitutes science. Because science, etymologically, science just means knowledge. And of course, you know, knowledge is a very good thing. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Okay, of course, there's nothing wrong with science. However, there is there's been a misuse of the word science, which I'll get to in a moment, but I better force myself to go step by step. Okay, so since science has become synonymous with the good, the best way to attack belief in God these days, given our culture, is to say that it is irrational, that it's unscientific, that God has been essentially scientifically disproven, that one must choose to accept either the scientific worldview and reject God, or accept God and reject science. So it's a choice. You have to pick one or the other. You have to pick science or you have to pick God. Now, once that framework is adopted, God has already lost the battle. Because, in fact, that entire premise of that battle is a total perversion of the very concept of science. The concept of science, the concept of knowledge, the concept of what it means to know something, because that's actually, of course, what it's all about. It's about knowing something, right? Because, of course, our culture would say, no, you can't know the truths of the faith. The truths of the faith are not rationally evidence-based knowable. They have to be accepted on blind faith. And unfortunately, even good Catholics sometimes make this mistake. Now, let me pull up that earlier Chesterton slide, which I think hits the nail on the head. When I'm asked as a purely intellectual question why I believe in the Catholic faith, I can only answer, I believe it quite rationally upon the evidence. Okay, which should mean that he believes it essentially scientifically, rationally upon the evidence. So where did this mistake about what science means come from? Okay, now historically, science has been defined as worthy of belief based on objective evidence. Now, in the course of this show, in the course of this series, I will go through plenty of objective evidence which clearly makes the Catholic faith worthy of belief based on objective evidence. And therefore, belief in the Catholic faith is in fact very, very scientific. However, let me go into where this mistake came from, that somehow it's unscientific or anti-scientific. St. Thomas Aquinas, of course, had a very legitimate definition of science. Scientific knowledge is attained when observable phenomena and their properties are accounted for in terms of their causes. Now, obviously, you know, the 100,000 people who saw the miracle at Fatima, observable phenomena that has been accounted for in terms of the cause. Medical miracles at Lourdes, observable phenomena accounted for in terms of their cause. Eucharistic miracles, observable phenomena accounted for in terms of their causes. So, according to the historical definition of science, and according to St. Thomas Aquinas' definition of science, there's nothing unscientific at all about believing in the Catholic faith and also believing in the miracles of the Catholic faith. In fact, by St. Thomas Aquinas' definition, nothing is more scientific than the Catholic faith, and nothing is less scientific than straight, strict materialism. That is, the belief that nothing exists except the physically observable material world. Boy, I wish you were live in front of me so I could see whether you're nodding your head or frowning or you know, with me or I'm being too redundant or whatever. But anyway, can't. So, however, let me go on with what happened to the definition of the word science. Okay, let me turn to the OED. OED just stands for Oxford English Dictionary. It's kind of like this wonderful, I don't know what it was before they got microscopic print. Maybe it was like 12 volumes. Now you can get it in like 2-3 inch thick volumes. But it always has been the like authoritative English dictionary. So let me turn to the definition of science in the OED, Oxford English Dictionary. It defines science as follows. The intellectual and practical activity encompassing the systematic study of the structure and behavior of the physical and natural world through observation and experiment. Now, think about that a moment. It's actually encouraging. I'll pull it up again. Because, in fact, the OED definition of science, in its very definition, says that it is limited to the physical and natural world. In other words, it's explicitly excluding the supernatural world or the preternatural world, because the scientific method, in fact, is limited to the physical and natural world by its very methodology. Okay, so if people stuck to this OED definition strictly, they'd say, oh, well, when we talk about the scientific method and so forth, it's not valid if we're not talking about the physical and natural world. the laws of the physical and natural world, because the whole point of miracles is that they violate the laws of the physical and natural world. They take place outside of the physical and natural world. Their causes are outside the physical and natural world, I should say, to be more precise. Going on to a further definition having to do with science, it's a quote, but I did not make a note of what, you know, kind of science journal it's a quote from. Reproducible results are the gold standard for science. Results are only worthy of attention if independent researchers can replicate them. That is actually the nub of the problem. The problem is I wish I had a slide for this, sorry. The entire concept of science has morphed into actually what's called logical positivism. So let me go to logical positivism. Maybe I'll have to come back, maybe not. Basically, the entire concept of science, scientific knowledge, therefore trustworthy or to be believed, has been hijacked by what's come to be known as the scientific method, which is a very good method for things that take place entirely in the physical and natural world. The scientific method being things have to be reproducible by measurable experiments at will, replicatable by anybody at will, resulting in measurable, observable results. That's a good method for figuring out chemical reactions or figuring out, you know, what happens if two balls collide or whatever. But the problem is, it's completely invalidated whenever there's any free will involved. But I'm getting ahead of myself, so let me go back to logical positivism. Logical positivism. The devil snuck in, I will argue, into our zeitgeist, into our concept of science and knowledge and so forth, about 100 years ago. Logical positivism basically dates its origin. You could make arguments, but its heyday was definitely the 20s and 30s, was when most of its development took place. It's based on older philosophy and so forth. Logical positivism is defined as, quote, a movement in Western philosophy whose central thesis was that only statements verifiable through reproducible experimentation are meaningful. No statement that can't be verified by reproducible experimentation is meaningful. It's not even meaningful to say God exists. It's not even meaningful to say miracles exist. It's not even meaningful to say that people have been miraculously healed at Lourdes, because it's not verifiable through reproducible experimentation. It's basically defining truth down. It's actually defining reality down to materialism. And the entire thrust of today's show is, in fact, that the entire pseudoscientific zeitgeist of our time is intrinsically entirely circular. This is the first time this has come up in this show, I guess. I mean, in this episode. But it's entirely circular. Basically, going back to this slide, you know, something is only true if it can be verified by reproducible experiments. The only things that can be verified by reproducible experiments are things that don't have anyone's free will involved. Therefore, nothing that has anyone's free will involved can exist. And therefore, miracles can't exist, because miracles require the free will of God or demons or angels. But in fact, a lot of human experience can't exist because it's not subject to reproducible experimentation. Attribute of logical positivism: a statement is cognitively meaningful only if some procedure conclusively determines its truth. Some procedure determines its truth, not some observation determines its truth. You see the incredible difference there? The observation of a medical miracle at Lourdes, that somebody goes into the baths crippled or blind and comes out of the bath seeing or well-bodied, able-bodied, that is evidence, that's observable. However, it's not a procedure that can be reproduced. So a statement is cognitively meaningful. In other words, you can only claim that a statement is true if some procedure conclusively determines its truth, not some evidence or some observation, but some procedure. So it means you have to be able to do it yourself. Now, as I alluded to earlier, that anything that is to be determined true by this yardstick must be reproducible by a controlled experiment by anyone with always the same results. Now, this eliminates any action dependent on a third party's free will by definition, whether that is the free will of a man, the free will of God, the free will of angels, or the free will of demons. Let me jump ahead to another Chesterton quote, if I can find it, here. It's sweet. It's a little bit long, but I better bring myself back up. But the point is, I mean, I'm going to go on to talk about why this logical positivism basically condemns belief in the existence of God through entirely circular reasoning. I think you probably already see that, in fact. G.K. Chesterton points out that it even contradicts the reality of human experience in the completely natural human plane. And he uses quite a entertaining little illustration for this. And all of my Chesterton quotes in this show are from a book that I can't recommend too highly, which is his book, Orthodoxy. In particular, chapter 9 of Orthodoxy. I believe all of these illustrations are drawn from, because he does a great job of poking fun and showing the holes in the claim that the faith is unscientific. So anyway, let me get to his entertaining example. Please forgive me for its length. This is a quote from Orthodoxy. Actually, let me fix it a moment. Oh, I can't fix it a moment. Okay, so I'll just bring it up again. Never mind. Okay. Whoops. Okay. The question of whether miracles ever occur is a question of common sense, not of any final physical experiment. One may here surely dismiss that quite brainless piece of pedantry, which talks about the need for scientific conditions in connection with alleged spiritual phenomena. If you choose to say, "I will believe that Miss Brown called her fiancé my heart's love, whom I love passionately," if she will only repeat the words before 17 psychologists, then I shall reply, "Very well, if those are your conditions, you will never get the truth, for she certainly will not say it under those conditions," right? Because the experiment involves a third party's free will, in this case, the romantically inclined young woman's free will, who has no interest in bearing her heart and expressing her passionate love behind, you know, in front of 17 psychologists in a laboratory. As Chesterton said, "Then I shall reply, very well, if those are your conditions, you will never get the truth, for she certainly will not say it." It is just as unscientific to be surprised that in an unsympathetic atmosphere, certain extraordinary sympathies do not arise. It is as though I said that I could not tell if there was a fog because the air was not clear enough, or if I insisted on perfect sunlight in order to see a solar eclipse. So his point is that the conditions being set out for acknowledging truth preclude any truth which is dependent on a subject's free will, a third party's free will, who will not be sympathetically inclined to the circumstances of the experimentation. Now, when the devil tried to tempt Jesus, or tempted Jesus, right, on top of the Mount of Temptation, and told Jesus, I think it was when he said, "Throw yourself off the top of this pinnacle because the angels will protect you," Jesus' reply, "It is also written in Scripture that you shall not put the Lord God to a test." to the test. God is not about to be subjected to a test by us in order to prove himself. You know, if he chooses to heal somebody at Lourdes, he chooses to heal somebody at Lourdes. If he chooses to make the sun dance in the sky in order to actually verify what was going on at Fatima, that's his sovereign choice. We're not about to say, okay, now that we have the video cameras rolling and CNN's crew here, if you exist, you have to do this or else we'll know you don't exist. I mean, that is so sacrilegious and so offensive. But it's basically what logical positivism is doing to every circumstance of the faith. I'll go on and I will support what I'm saying. My father once condemned, he read a final exam I wrote at Harvard Business School that got like the top grade. And his critique was, oh, you say something good and you say it over again and over again and over again. So excuse me, I have been doing that for a long time, apparently, is repeating myself. But anyway, back to the mainstream. What is a miracle? By definition, a miracle is an event in which the normal physical laws are suspended by an intervention from the spiritual world, which by definition is a free will act of God or an angel or a demon. Therefore, it is not subject to experiment or to reproducibility. So what you see here is that the logical positivism that has kind of infiltrated our culture to be the definition of what's true. Because the logical positive, remember the chain here, science is good, therefore scientific method is good. Scientific method requires this arbitrary reproducibility. Therefore, if miracles exist, they have to be artificially reproduced at will. Since miracles can't be reproduced at will, miracles can't exist. Entirely circular reasoning. If it's not subject to the scientific method, it doesn't exist. Anything that involves free will is not subject to the scientific method because somebody may decide to do it or not. Therefore, miracles don't exist. I'm not doing a great job of it, but maybe if I repeat it enough times, it'll make sense. Or I'll make, you know, it's just circular reasoning. And in fact, all of the disproofs of the faith end up being circular reasoning. We saw in the study of evolution. What incredible circular reasoning, right? Okay, the theory doesn't work, but it must be true anyway because there's no alternative because God doesn't exist and therefore evolution is true. And therefore we know there's no need to postulate that God might exist. Just circular reasoning everywhere you look. And they say we're the illogical ones. I'll get to that eventually. Okay, so here's G.K. Chesterton talking more about the circularity of reasoning. Always circular reasoning. Here's Chesterton again in Orthodoxy. If I say that medieval documents attest certain miracles as much as they attest to certain battles, they will answer, but medievals were superstitious. If I want to know in what they were superstitious, the only ultimate answer is they believed in the miracles. If I say a peasant saw a ghost, I am told, but peasants are so credulous. If I ask why credulous, the only answer is that they see ghosts. It's just a circular reasoning over again. And continuing with Chesterton on the same theme, the skeptic may say that the miracle could only come to him who believed in it. Well, it may be so. And if so, how are we to test it? Suppose we were investigating whether angry men really saw a red mist before their eyes. Suppose 60 excellent householders swore that when angry they had seen this crimson cloud. Surely it would be absurd to answer, "Oh, but you admit that you were angry at the time." They might reasonably rejoin in a stentorian chorus, "How the blazes could we discover without being angry whether angry people see red?" And so the saints and ascetics might rationally reply, "Suppose the question is whether believers can see visions. Even then, if you are interested in visions, It is no point to object to believers. You are still arguing in a circle. He does a better job than I can. See, it's circular reasoning. If you say that, you know, only faithful Catholics get healed at Lourdes through their because they're praying earnestly, and then you say, well, I'm not going to believe it because all of the eyewitnesses or all of the people who were healed or claimed they were healed were faithful Catholics and they're biased. So it would have to be somebody who isn't a faithful Catholic who's healed at Lourdes. Then you are engaging in entirely circular reasoning. Just like if you said, I'm not going to believe the testimony of an angry man about whether he sees red when you get angry. By the way, that's happened to me. Doesn't speak well of me. But once, literally, I got so angry that I did see red. I don't know what it is, whether it's little blood vessels in your retina bursting or whatever. Or again, that only believers see visions, and therefore we can't believe that visions exist because they're only ever seen by believers. You know, you have to apply a different logic if you want to disprove or discredit an overwhelming mountain of credible evidence and testimony. Now, I will skip to, maybe I don't have to skip, okay? So let me just kind of draw this little line of reasoning to a close. The devil achieved his victory not by disproving the miraculous, disproving God, but by defining the rules of truth to, by definition, exclude the possibility of accepting the miraculous. I would say that if anybody buys this slide top to bottom, you can save a lot of time and not watch any of this series that I'm doing, because in fact, this is a series in a nutshell, that the devil's victory over our zeitgeist, over our current consciousness, didn't come from disproving the miraculous or coming up with any evidence disproving the existence of God at all. His victory came by redefining the rules of truth to, by definition, exclude the possibility of accepting the miraculous and therefore accepting any objective, external, physical proof of the truths of the Catholic faith, in which we abound, 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 abound. And I don't know how many episodes I'll have in this series. Maybe I'll do 12 again. But, you know, we could have 100 hours on medical miracles at Lourdes. We could have 100 hours on Eucharistic miracles. We could have 100 hours on things that saints did, or things that saints knew, or bilocations of saints and miracles performed by saints, or, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours of perfectly, objectively verifiable evidence for the truths of the Catholic faith. However, as the slide says, the devil achieved his victory not by disproving all of this evidence, but by defining the rules of truth to say it's not evidence at all, for no good reason. Now, okay. Now, I looked up, there's a horrible journal that I don't recommend that any of you ever look at. It's called The Skeptical Inquirer. What's the subtitle say? Magazine for Science and Reason. Excuse me. It's a magazine that purports to simply look into evidence for the supernatural or for miracles or for God and disprove them all by science and reason. And it's ludicrous. I mean, it's entertaining how ludicrous it is. But here is its mantra, so to speak, you know, almost its motto. It's called arguing from ignorance. They call it arguing from ignorance, or argument from ignorance. Calling something a miracle because there is no natural explanation for it. It's nothing less than the logical fallacy called arguing from ignorance. let me just put in a note here. It's not a logical fallacy. In other words, arguing from ignorance is not a logical fallacy. The skeptical inquirer is engaging in the logical fallacy in what it's saying in this slide. Okay? Calling something a miracle because there is no natural explanation is nothing less than the logical fallacy called arguing from ignorance. One cannot draw a conclusion from a lack of knowledge. Yet it is the way miracle claims are typically made, in a shrewd attempt to have dogma seem to trump science. No, in fact, it's a successful attempt in having science trump dogma. The dogma that miracles don't exist is trumped by science, by objective evidence. Now, to illustrate the fallacy in this supposed fallacy being pointed out by the skeptical inquirer called arguing from ignorance, I apologize for the, bear with me a moment. I apologize for the vulgarity of the example, but it's the one that came to mind. Imagine the father of a 16-year-old girl who comes home and says, I'm pregnant. And the father says, you shouldn't have done that. You shouldn't have slept with your boyfriend. And the girl says, I didn't sleep with my boyfriend. And the father says, you must have slept with your boyfriend because you're pregnant now. Now, is that a logical conclusion that the father made, that his daughter must have slept with someone because she's pregnant? Or is he engaging in the logical fallacy of arguing from ignorance? Because just because he can't think of another explanation of how she got pregnant other than losing her virginity, he is arguing from ignorance and is completely illegitimate in concluding that she in fact engaged in relations with a man and hence got pregnant. I think everyone would agree that the father is not jumping to an unwarranted conclusion by saying, since there's no other explanation, I think I can accept this explanation as being the true one. Sherlock Holmes famously said, it's in like all of his little mystery stories to Watson, when we have eliminated the improbable, my dear Watson, when we have eliminated the impossible, my dear Watson, whatever remains, however improbable, is the truth. So you just can't do it. You just can't say, you know, you can't have this mountain of evidence for miracles for which the only explanation is that the faith is true and say it's not evidence at all. You're simply pointing out that you're ignorant. I hope that made sense. Okay, going on. And again, I apologize for the vulgarity of my example, but it's the one that jumped into my mind. So I am just going to go back to my leitmotif for the show. This quote from Chesterton: if it comes to human testimony, there is a choking cataract of human testimony in favor of the supernatural. If you reject it, you can only mean one of two things. You deny the testimony of ordinary people, or you affirm the main principle of materialism, the abstract impossibility of a miracle. You have the perfect right to do so. But in that case, you are the dogmatist. It is we Christians who accept all actual evidence. It is you rationalists who refuse actual evidence, being constrained to do so by your creed. So again, remember the last sentence here. It is the way miracle claims are typically made in a shrewd attempt to have dogma seem to trump science. No, it is you, Mr. Skeptical Inquirer, who is making dogma in fact trump science, because you are holding on to your dogma that there are no miracles, despite a cataract, a mountain of basically scientific evidence, objectively verifiable, observable, physical evidence. So anyway, okay. Moving on to Lourdes. I hope to get to this story by the end of the show. Moving on to Lourdes. You all know the story of Lourdes. I'm going to humiliate myself. The year was 18... 62. Someone is going to type that in, probably. Anyway, it was around then. You know that the Blessed Virgin Mary appeared to a very ignorant, extremely poor girl in the town of Lourdes named Bernadette, and had her come back repeatedly. The Blessed Virgin Mary appeared repeatedly and so, repeatedly and so forth. Let me turn to my notes since I've gotten to this part of my this show. I don't have very good notes, so you'll have to bear with me. But anyway, you all know the story of Lourdes, I'm sure. And a spring sprung up there, and the Blessed Virgin Mary told Saint Bernadette, now Saint Bernadette, of course, that pilgrims should come there and pray, and there'll be many healings and so forth. There were healings even in the very early days of the apparitions going on from the water at Lourdes and so forth. I'm sorry, I didn't prepare this little piece of the show, so I'm going to kind of skip over it. It was around 1860s that the apparitions took place, and Lourdes instantly actually became a huge pilgrimage site. And there were many, 1858. Thank you, Manuela. Many, very dramatic physical healings. And then in 1905, because there were so many healings, and the Pope at the time wanted to get a little rigor behind it, in 1905, Pope Pius X decreed that claims of miraculous cures at Lourdes must submit to a proper process. And in order to be that proper process, the Lourdes Medical Bureau was formed. The Medical Bureau has dozens of doctors. I think it's a minimum of 20 experts. They investigate all of the claims to medical miracles at Lourdes. They examine the patient. They take all of the physical evidence, the examination of the patient, including psychological examination, the case notes of the patient's physicians, the test results, biopsies, x-rays, CAT scans, blood test results, you know, everything that you'd have in modern medicine. Of course, what we have in modern medicine in 2020 is different from what they had in modern medicine of 1905. But, you know, they already had x-rays, I believe, and they already had, you know, lots of physical documentation and so forth. And in any case, the Medical Bureau at Lourdes then investigates every detail of the claim. It ensures that the latest knowledge is applied. It refers the evidence to a number of experts. It's, I am looking for here. And it actually does not declare a medical healing a miracle. All it does is declare a medical healing, a healing rather, being medically inexplicable. In other words, since they're scientists and not theologians, they're not using the word miracle, they're using inexplicable. They're saying there is no currently known physical explanation for what took place. In any case, the original diagnosis must be verified and confirmed beyond doubt. The diagnosis must have been regarded as incurable. The cure must happen in Lourdes or at a shrine to Lourdes, actually. The cure must be immediate, instant. It must be complete, and it must be permanent. So they won't rule on a healing for at least 5 years to make sure it is permanent. A two-thirds vote of the Medical Bureau is required before it's pronounced inexplicable. They're not allowed to be all Catholics. I don't remember the percentage that's allowed to be Catholic. And they're not even allowed to be all believers, I believe. And to date, over 1,200 of these healings has been declared inexplicable by the Medical Bureau at Lourdes, and over 4,000 declared probable, probably inexplicable. Only about 70 have been declared miracles. And the reason that so few have been declared miracles is that once the Medical Bureau declares it inexplicable, the bishop of the patient, of the person cured, has to start a canonical process to have it declared as a miracle, which is very expensive. They have to go through all of the documentation again. They have to get all of the testimony again. They have to submit it to Rome. Costs hundreds of thousands of dollars. So usually when one of these patients who's miraculously cured returns home to his diocese, the bishop doesn't really want to invest in having it declared a miracle, very reasonably. The person is healed. I don't think the person really cares about whether they go down in the record books as an official miracle or just as an inexplicable healing. I had a miraculous cure, not at Lourdes, but at the tomb of Saint Bernadette. So if I get to that part of the show, I'll mention that. It wasn't examined by anyone, though, so you know, you don't have to believe me. It's not like the, you know, the ones that go through the Lourdes Medical Bureau. Anyway, so the main, I don't want to say the main part of the show, but okay, here's why I'm doing the show the way I'm doing it. The rest of the show, if I don't have extra time, is going to be spent on the contrast between Emile Zola and Franz Werfel. They're two men who found themselves in Lourdes. One of them with a closed heart, and I'll tell his story, he's Emile Zola, and one of them with an open heart, who is Jewish, very close to my heart, being Jewish, and his whole life was intertwined with conversion of Judaism to Catholicism, because his life is very intertwined with that of Mahler. He married Mahler's widow, Alma Mahler, who was with him at Lourdes, and he reportedly entered the Catholic Church before he died and died a Catholic. Supposedly he was baptized in a monastery in Austria. So anyway, at least a priest testified to that. So the rest of the show, it's around this, the setting is Lourdes, and the vignettes, there are two vignettes, the vignette of Emile Zola and the vignette of Franz Werfel. And they're both, I think, really interesting stories in their own right. And so it'll make a very cute illustration of what's going on in this entire science versus faith discussion, which is, it's a matter, if you have goodwill, there's plenty of evidence for the truth of the Catholic faith. If you don't have goodwill, no amount of evidence is sufficient. It's basically what it amounts to. So, getting to Emile Zola and Franz Werfel. Okay, Emile Zola, dishonest skeptic. He was a famous, very famous French writer and journalist of the late 19th century. If any of you have heard of the Dreyfus trial, he was actually responsible for exposing the frame-up of Dreyfus and getting him pardoned. And if I had more time, I would tell the story of the Dreyfus trial and Emile Zola, simply because it's really interesting. It's a deep state story. There was a deep state. It's exactly what you see in the United States today with Flynn, with, you know, with the prosecution of people who, I don't know what you would say, are potential supporters of Trump, versus the lack of prosecution of people who are fighting on the side of the good of the deep state. They become made into heroes and so forth. It's a very parallel story. And it was in the 19th century in France. The deep state is not new. And in fact, I'm pretty sure that the deep state that went on in the Dreyfus trial was also interwoven with the Masons. And I'm pretty sure the current deep state is interwoven with the Masons. That's probably the subject, potential subject of another series. Anyway, on to staying on Zola. Okay, he was famous for being anti-clerical, in other words, opposed to the Catholic faith, opposed to the Catholic Church, and a skeptic, in other words, not believing anything having to do with God or faith. He said, before he went to Lourdes, he said, quote, "Only nervous cases are healed at Lourdes. If I saw a cut finger dipped into the water and come out whole, I would believe." So he's pretending that he's an honest witness. He's pretending that he's ready to believe. All he would have to do is see a cut finger dipped into the water come out whole, and he would believe. Wait until you see what he saw and what his response was. He is going to be contrasted with Franz Werfel, who was honest, I will argue. He was an unbelieving Jew. He was atheist. His parents were essentially atheist, but he was honest. And his experience at Lourdes resulted in him writing Song of Bernadette. Many of you, I think, know the movie, if not the novel. Millions of copies of the novel. Well, millions of people saw the movie. And it really made the story of Lourdes really, really well known around the world. And because he was just honest about his experience. Okay, Emile Zola, though. I'm starting with Emile Zola. So, okay. Here's a portrait of Emile Zola. Let's see what I have for you here. Okay, so I told you what he said before he went down. He said, only nervous cases are healed at Lourdes. If I saw a cut finger dipped into the water and come out whole, I would believe. Now, riding down to Lourdes, he was in a train car with an 18-year-old young woman named Marie Le Marchand. Somebody asked in the chat stream, where's the evidence for this story of Zola's fraud? And my answer was, because I didn't have time to look up my notes and find the, you know, reference that I was using. If you just Google Marie Le Marchand, spelled right, like it's there, the references to her, especially in Google Books, will point to passages in a lot of books which recount this situation, this case. It's heavily documented. I even have a photograph you'll see later in this, a couple slides down. So Zola rode down in the train with this young woman. She had three incurable diseases at once. She had advanced lupus, and Zola described her face, and a doctor down at Lourdes described it the same way. Her face was mostly eaten away by lupus. As Zola described it, the whole of her face was a frightful distorted mass of matter and oozing blood. As though that were not enough, she also had pulmonary tuberculosis, and she also had leg ulcerations the size of an adult's hand. And Zola rode down on the train with this Marie Le Marchand, and he described her condition. He described what she looked like. Now, there was a doctor. I didn't use the space on the slide to put up his name, Dr. D'Ambre. Dr. D'Ambre was present when Marie Le Marchand went into the baths. He later testified the following. I was struck by her particularly revolting face. Both cheeks, the lower part of her nose, and her upper lip were covered with a tuberculous ulcer that secreted matter abundantly. Then he was also there when she came out of the baths. The same Dr. D'Ambre testified, her face had changed completely. In place of the hideous ulcer I had just seen, the face was red, it is true, but dry and covered with new skin. The similar sore on her leg had also dried up. I was amazed by this sudden change. The doctor turned to Zola, saying, Ah! Monsieur Zola, behold the case of your dreams. And what was Zola's response? I don't want to look at her. To me, she is still ugly. And he walked away. And he later said, Were I to see all of the sick at Lourdes cured, I would not believe in a miracle. So there you have it. That is really the story. That's the story of skepticism. The story of skepticism is essentially, you know, it really doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what the proof is. It doesn't matter what the evidence is. If it contradicts my dogma, I refuse to believe it. It's an act of the will. It's an act of the will against science, against truth, against evidence. I'm not particularly proud of being a Catholic. I hope I'm humbled by being a Catholic. But we have all the evidence. We have all the proof. We have all the science. Don't let them tell you they have the science and we have the faith. You know, they have the science and we have the dogma. It's not true. Remember Morpheus? We have the science. They have the dogma. We have the red pill. They have the blue pill. It's not us with the blue pill and them with the red pill. It's us with the red pill and them with the blue pill. We have the science. They have the dogma. Remember what Zola said when he saw her coming out of the baths. Were I to see all the sick at Lourdes cured, I would not believe in a miracle. Okay, they're the blue pill folk. By the way, if you didn't see the previous shows, that metaphor of Morpheus and the blue pill and the red pill come from Matrix, which I thoroughly enjoyed. I'm not saying it's a edifying movie, but there's some interesting thoughts that are presented in it. But don't watch Matrix 2 and Matrix 3, because just because I liked Matrix, I tried watching a sequel and it was, it didn't last 5 minutes. Okay, so I'm not here to talk about Matrix. I'm here to talk about Lourdes. So back to Lourdes. Now, you saw here what Zola's response was. I don't want to look at her. To me, she is still ugly. Were I to see all the sick at Lourdes cured, I would not believe in a miracle. So pretty evidently, I hope, conclude that he's a pretty dishonest guy. Doesn't show a whole lot of integrity. Doesn't have a huge care for truth. Let me show you a quote from the New York Times. Okay, first of all, let me back up and say, Zola had gone down, I'm sorry, I apologize for being out of sequence. Zola had gone to Lourdes because he was going to write a book debunking Lourdes. That was the reason for his trip. The whole reason for his trip was to write a book proving that there are no genuine healings at Lourdes. He saw a number of genuine healings. He saw the one of Marie Le Marchand, and he saw another one of Marie Le Branchu, who I'll talk about in a moment. And yet, when he returned to Paris, he wrote his book. And did he write his book admitting to what he had seen? No. He wrote his book denying that any real miracles ever took place at Lourdes, that any real healings ever took place at Lourdes. He continued to argue what he had argued before, which was in his book, Debunking Lourdes, he basically claimed that all of the so-called healings at Lourdes were autosuggestion or hypnotism or due to the shock of cold water or due to the healing inspiration of the crowd or due to the curative effect of the monotonous repetition of litanies and Ave Marias. Now, let's look at what's kind of funny about this list of explanations. Autosuggestion. I mean, really what's funny is that some of these don't exist and the others are trivial. Autosuggestion, that if you think you're healed, somehow the body has the ability to heal. You can be crippled with an inch and a half of bone missing from your leg. This is a documented miracle there, documented by x-rays and so forth. But because you think you're healed, that inch and a half of bone instantly has grown back. This is just autosuggestion. I mean, basically, you make up a name for something that doesn't exist, and because you have a name for it, it all of a sudden exists. This is the scientific, so to speak, the materialistic explanation for the miracle at Lourdes, at Fatima. The miracle of the sun at Fatima, seen by, 80 or 100,000 people, is it was a mass hallucination doesn't exist. Doesn't matter. They made up a name for it, and therefore they have an explanation, and it exists. So autosuggestion is an explanation in Zola's book. Hypnotism is an explanation in Zola's book, which really must mean autosuggestion, because there are no hypnotists putting people into a trance, right? Shock of cold water, that always produces miraculous healings. Maybe of hangovers, but of nothing more serious than a hangover. The healing inspiration of the crowd, what's that supposed to mean? The curative effect of monotonous repetition of litanies and Ave Marias. This should be made fun of, okay? But I came across a New York Times review of a new biography of Zola, okay? So anyway, let me get to that slide. So Zola went ahead and wrote his book. Those are the explanations he gave for any purported miraculous healings at Lourdes. He included the account of Marie, but he said she was not healed. She was not healed, okay? This Marie, Le Marchand, was not healed. So he described her accurately, but said there was no improvement, okay? Now, Dr. Boisserie, who was on the medical bureau at Lourdes, was so indignant when he read Zola's book that he actually took the train to Paris and confronted him about that. And I will talk about that in a moment. But let me talk about the New York Times, right? Because we know that the New York Times, all the news that's fit to print, it would never lie. It is the source of the truth in our culture today. That's why we know that Trump should be removed by the 25th Amendment to the Constitution, because he's mentally handicapped and insane and therefore mentally incompetent to be president. We know that because the New York Times says it. We know that we're all going to die from the pandemic because the New York Times said it. Or that the only reason we didn't die is because de Blasio was such a genius because the New York Times said it, and so forth and so on. So here's the New York Times recent review of a biography of Zola. Zola was the bitter enemy of authoritarianism, obscurantism, and racial prejudice. He was the forceful man of reason. Truth and justice are his slogans. Truth and justice are his slogans, okay? He claimed that Marie Le Marchand was not healed. He wrote that in his book. Dr. Boisserie traveled to Paris to confront him about it. And Dr. Boisserie actually went so far as to give public talks. And at the public talks, he had present Marie Le Branchu. So he had the healed woman present at the public talks. What am I doing here? Okay. And so that everybody could see, and the news reports, give an account of it, of this attractive young woman who was standing next to him, who he would point out as the recipient of the miracle of the healing. So let me zoom in a little bit on that slide. And here we have a little zoomed in picture. There you see Dr. Boisserie. You see he's at the podium. There's a statue of the Blessed Mother at Lourdes, Our Lady of Lourdes, behind him. And he's pointing to a young woman standing next to him. And she is the very same Marie LeBron. Le Marchand. The two miraculous healings involved in his book was Marie Le Marchand and Marie Le Branchu. So that's why I keep tripping over my tongue. This is Marie Le Marchand standing next to him. So there you see it. And he was running around Paris. I mean, Dr. Boisserie was running around Paris showing off Marie Le Marchand, contradicting Zola's claim that she was not healed. This is the New York Times icon of truth and justice. If I can indulge in French, le plus ça change is a French expression. The more things change, the more they remain the same. Apparently that's true of the New York Times. Anyway, okay. Now there was another example that Zola described in his book. He cited the case of Mademoiselle Le Branchu. Her lungs had been eaten away by tuberculosis. She didn't have long to live. She went into the cold water of the baths. After 3 minutes in the bath, her strength returned, and she danced into the medical bureau shouting, "I am cured, I am cured." However, when Zola wrote up her case in his book, he wrote that she temporarily felt better because of the invigorating effect of the cold water, but she died on the train home, okay? However, This was rather an embarrassment to Zola because she was still alive and people started talking about her being still alive and the word started getting out. She was dirt poor. I mean, she was very, very poor. And in those days, by the way, being poor didn't mean that you didn't have a flat screen TV. Being poor meant you didn't have enough to eat. In fact, Bernadette, you know, the visionary at Lourdes, Bernadette at Lourdes, when she was fully grown, was 4'7". And the reason was because she was basically on a starvation diet as a child. She didn't have enough to eat. And one of the things the body does if you don't have enough to eat is to keep you alive. It holds back on growth. It actually happened to Elie Wiesel also, his short stature, and Roman Polanski also. I think Roman Polanski was in the siege of Leningrad or something. I may have the years wrong, but in any case, he didn't have enough nutrition growing up, so he's very short, but not as short as Bernadette, who's 4'7". But that's all by way of saying that Mademoiselle Le Branchu was very, very poor, starvation poor. And so Zola offered her and her husband a lifetime pension to basically pay them for the rest of their lives if she would disappear, move to a village in Belgium for the rest of her life. And she accepted because of her poverty. Okay, this is the icon of truth and justice. Okay, he wants to lie about the evidence. She is living evidence showing that he lies. So what's he do? He bribes her to disappear so that the evidence doesn't exist. Okay. So I don't have to go back to the Chesterton quote. You get the point. Here I'm going back to the Chesterton quote. Okay. The believers in miracles accept them because they have the evidence. The disbelievers deny them because they have a doctrine against them. Again, the theme of this series. Now, let me move to a very happy topic. Maybe it'll be the close of the show, which is Franz Werfel. Now, Franz Werfel, he was a Jew. Let me turn to the notes. I probably don't even have the good notes. Okay. He grew up in Czechoslovakia. I think it was Prague. It was a wealthy family. His family, I'll get me back on. I keep forgetting. A wealthy Jewish mercantile family, without the faith. I mean, just cultural Jews. They had a Catholic governess who the little boy Werfel was very fond of, and who would always take him to mass, by the way, which is very interesting because he loved going to mass with his Catholic governess. He was actually educated at Catholic school because other rich Jews at the time in Prague were educated in a Catholic school because it was the best school around. It was run by the Pietists, which were a teaching order. Now, Werfel. Okay, he ended up being married. I'm going to describe. I'm trying to think of how to do this. Okay, he was stuck during World War II, which is obviously much later than when he was growing up. I don't have the date in front of me, but let's say he was born 1890, let's say, 1880, somewhere around there. Is that true? If he was born in 1880, he would have been about 60, maybe born around 1890. He was very much wanted by the Nazis during World War II because he had written, he was an author, he was a writer. He was a playwright and a novelist and a journalist, and he had written against the Third Reich, and he had written against the Nazis, and he had actually written against the Armenian genocide. He made known the Armenian genocide in Europe. That's very interesting to me, that he was actually a champion of the Christians who were genocided. I don't know what the number is, 1 million, 2 million, by the Turks, in other words, by the Muslims in Turkey. As a matter of fact, when Hitler started his campaign to exterminate the Jews, And he was told, you're not going to get away with it. Hitler's response was, what do you mean? Nobody talks about the Armenian genocide anymore. Everyone's forgotten it. You know, if the Turks got away, if the Muslims got away with the Armenian genocide, I can get away with the genocide of the Jews. Werfel wrote a novel that actually exposed the Armenian genocide, which is why the Nazis were so after him. Anyway, so he's trapped in the Pyrenees. He's trying to escape to Spain and from there to the United States. He doesn't have a visa to cross the border. He's trapped at Lourdes with his wife, Alma Mahler. Okay, so that's obviously in the 40s. Now I'm going to go back to his earlier in his life. I wish I had the dates in front of me. I apologize. But anyway, you know, as a young man, he fell in love. He met Alma Mahler. He fell in love with her. He married her. She was with him in the Pyrenees. She was Catholic, although she wasn't a very good example of the Catholic faith. She was with him in the Pyrenees, and actually, she was his wife for the rest of his life. But she's a very interesting character, and she's too interesting a character for me to skip over without going into details about Alma Mahler. Now, you might have noticed from her last name that she had been married to Gustav Mahler, who is the composer of the music that was the introduction music. Gustav Mahler was also a Jewish to Catholic convert, very passionately Catholic convert, who had been raised Jewish. So let me indulge a little bit about Alma Mahler. First of all, a little bit of her biography, okay? She was born in 1879. She was actually older than Werfel. She was the most beautiful girl in Vienna. She was referred to. She loved, I don't know how to say it. You know what? I'm not going to say it. I'm not even going to put up this bio straight. I'm going to take a little break and have some fun. So I'm having fun actually with the entire show. But there is a comic songwriter named Tom Lehrer, who is also, by the way, Jewish, but not a Jewish convert, unfortunately. And he wrote a song commemorating Alma Mahler when her obituary appeared in 1964 in the New York Times. It'll give you a feeling for her biography, and then I'll go back to her biography. It's her biography. It'll be in front of you while this song plays, so let me hope the technology works.
December 13th, there appeared in the newspapers the juiciest, spiciest, raciest obituary. It was that of a lady named Alma Mahler Gropius Werfel, who had, in her lifetime, managed to acquire, as lovers, practically all of the top creative men in Central Europe. And among these lovers, there were three whom she went so far as to marry. One of the leading composers of the day, Gustav Mahler, composer of Das Lied von der Erde and other light classics. One of the leading architects, Walter Gropius, of the Bauhaus School of Design. And one of the leading writers, Franz Werfel, author of The Song of Bernadette and other masterpieces. It seemed to me, on reading this obituary, that the story of Alma was the stuff of which ballads should be made. So here is one. The loveliest girl in Vienna was Alma, the smartest as well. Once you picked her up on your antenna, you'd never be free of her spell. Her lovers were many and varied. From the day she began her begin, there were three famous ones whom she married, and God knows how many between. Alma, tell us, all modern women are jealous. Which of your magical wands got you Gustav and Walter and Franz? The first one she married was Mahler, whose buddies all knew him as Gustav. And each time he saw her, he'd holler, ach, that is the Fräulein I must have. Alma, tell us, all modern women are jealous. You should have a statue in bronze for bagging Gustav and Walter and Franz. While married to Gus, she met Gropius, and soon she was swinging with Walter. Gus died and her teardrops were copious. She cried all the way to the altar. While married to Walt, she'd met Werfel, and he too was caught in her net. He married her, but he was careful, 'cause Alma was no Bernadette. And that is the story of Alma, who knew how to receive and to give. The body that reached her embalma was one that had known how to live. Alma, tell us, how can they help being jealous? Ducks always envy the swans who get Gustav and Walter. You never did falter with Gustav and Walter and Franz.
Okay, I actually had to edit that to make it less vulgar. But anyway, basically, she was a Mahler's piano student. When she was 21, he was 41. He fell in love with her. They got married. She was not a very faithful wife, I think, to any of her husbands. And they kind of tolerated, I must say, it doesn't speak well for high society at the time. But in any case, while she was married to Mahler, she met Gropius, and Walter Gropius, who's like the really, really big architect of the Bauhaus school. They fell in love with each other. Gropius wrote her continual love letters while she was still married to Mahler. But then while she was also still married to Mahler, she had a 3-year affair with Oskar Kokoschka, who apparently is one of the great artists of the period, until he was drafted into the German army after 3 years. And then when Mahler died in 1911, Alma married Gropius. But then when she was married to Gropius, she met Werfel, and they had a son together who died. And then in 1911, she divorced Gropius and married Werfel eventually in 1929. She wouldn't marry him until he promised to renounce Judaism, essentially, that he to no longer consider himself Jewish or something along those lines. She wasn't going to be married to a Jew, basically, is what it amounted to. And along the way, other affairs of her include, and these guys are all famous. They're not famous enough to be famous to us, you know, 80 years later, but they were really famous in their day. And there's a list of their Gerhard Hauptmann, a German dramatist and poet, Dr. Paul Kramer-Murr, biologist, and Osip Gavrilovich, a Russian pianist and conductor, who ended up marrying actually Mark Twain's daughter. So as Tom Lehrer said, all modern women are jealous. Which of your magical wands got you Gustav and Walter and Franz? So anyway, that was just a little light entertainment in the middle here. So here is a interesting picture. That is Alma Mahler as a young woman on the left, clearly a very attractive young woman. And there on the right is actually a picture of Franz Werfel. He's this short man that looks like he's somewhat deformed. That's Alban Berg, actually, is standing next to him, who was another, let's say, close friend of Alma Mahler's. Somehow her lovers seemed, it was a strange social circle, that it was kind of okay. But in any case, it does look a little like Beauty and the Beast when you think of the couple of Alma Mahler and Franz Werfel there on the right. So, okay, then they find themselves, jump fast forward to, I don't even have the year in front of me. I should, you know, whatever it was, 1942 maybe, something like that. Certainly 1943 plus or minus a year. They have made their way across Europe, escaping from the Nazis hot on Werfel's trail. They've made it to Lourdes, which of course is the, it's right up against the Pyrenees. I mean, you know, you cross the Pyrenees from Lourdes and you're over in Spain, but they couldn't get into Spain. They're trapped there. Werfel, of course, expects to die there when the Nazis catch up with him. And he, meanwhile, is just waiting there, waiting, praying in some sense, And there was a memoir written by a friend of Werfel's who was with him in Lourdes. There were 80,000 refugees in Lourdes at the time, by the way, stuck in Lourdes, who were trying to cross the Pyrenees and escape the Nazis. My mother was actually picked up trying to cross over into Spain. She was picked up by the Gestapo. That's another story. She managed, obviously, to escape. But anyway, look at the map of France. I mean, you had all the Jews, actually all the Jews of Europe, essentially, almost. Some of them fled through Turkey, actually. But the only way you could flee from the Nazis was like through Turkey, trying to get to Palestine, or going west. And you'd end up at the Pyrenees, essentially. You'd end up, because Spain was free under Franco, but France was under the Nazi occupation. So you'd be stuck there at the border between France up against the Pyrenees with Spain on the other side, and Lourdes is right there. So there are 80,000, probably mostly Jewish refugees trying to flee, stuck in and around Lourdes. And so one of them writes this account of what Werfel was like at the time. And what she wrote was, "I saw the deep emotion of Franz Werfel. Never before had he been so profoundly shaken in all his being. A new world had opened before him, and he plunged into it with all his eagerness. I liked to answer his questions, because I saw that what was going on was much more than merely the enthusiasm of a poet. In other words, his heart was open, and his soul was being stirred by the Blessed Virgin Mary at Lourdes," which is one heck of a good place to have your heart stirred by the Blessed Virgin Mary. And, you know, there's an old saying, there are no atheists in foxholes, you know, expecting his life to end any day under the most horrible circumstances, I'm sure, also helped open his heart. And when he was at Lourdes, here's his own account. Werfel listened to the story of Bernadette over and over. What else are you going to do when you're stuck at Lourdes? And in his own words, "One day, in my great distress, I made a vow. I vowed that if I escaped from this desperate situation and reached the saving shore of America, I would put off all other tasks and sing as best I could the song of Bernadette." Well, he did so. They did manage to escape. They did make it to the United States, Alma and Werfel. And Werfel immediately wrote The Song of Bernadette, which became a novel, which was a bestseller. It set him up probably for life, actually, the income from the novel. And he also wrote the screenplay for the movie that most of us have seen. And many thousands read the book. Millions saw the movie. And the Blessed Virgin Mary was probably faithful to in her gratitude. And according to a priest who claims he witnessed it, Franz Werfel was received into the church at a monastery in Austria before he died in 1945. I have not been able to very deeply verify that. That's why I, you know, have a slight caveat there. In any case, that's the story. That's the story, basically. That's the story of Franz Werfel and Emile Zola. That's the story of rejecting evidence in favor of the dogma of skepticism or atheism versus simply allowing yourself to be moved by God. Now, I wish I had it here, but I don't have it here anymore. But you remember that slide I had in earlier shows of Jesus knocking at the door? You know, I stand at the door and knock. So Jesus stands at the door and knocks, and he wants nothing more than to be with us in heaven forever, for us to be with him in heaven forever. He wants nothing more than that we receive him and that we make our way to heaven. The only thing that stands in the way is our contrary free will. The only thing that keeps that door locked shut is our refusal to open it, our unwillingness to open it, because he invites all of us. And so this is a wonderful illustration of somebody who refused to open the door, didn't care how loud the knocking was, which would be Zola, and somebody who heard the knocking and had honesty and had integrity, unlike the New York Times' opinion of Zola, and let Jesus in the door and became actually a hero for the Catholic faith in a sense. How many people did Franz Werfel bring into the church through the Song of Bernadette or the book The Song of Bernadette or simply making Lourdes known? So it's a very, very beautiful illustration. Where should I go from here? It's 4:30. I just have a couple of minutes. Okay. Boy, I wish I could do more. Maybe I'll start. I don't even know what the next show is going to be. Maybe I'll weave in some more miracles of Lourdes. But I want to mention, I don't want to give you teasers that I don't live up to. So I'll mention my miraculous healing that is connected to Lourdes, although it didn't take place at Lourdes, just for what it's worth. You can believe it or not. You all know the story of Lourdes. Just some pretty slides. There, of course, is the grotto at Lourdes, the statue of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Oops, I'm going to shut that off. That is actually the Lourdes hymn, but I don't want to talk over it. There is the statue that's put in the alcove in the rock where the Blessed Virgin Mary appeared. Bernadette was essentially on the front of that pavement. It wasn't pavement, of course, it was dirt at the time. There's an altar in that grotto. That's what Lourdes looks like today. Many of the miraculous healings at Lourdes, by the way, take place not from the waters, including, by the way, they take place during the Eucharistic procession. So there is a little slide of the Eucharistic procession at Lourdes. People kneel down when the Blessed Sacrament goes by, and many of the very, very dramatic healings take place during the Eucharistic procession, not in the waters themselves. There is a picture of Saint Bernadette as a girl, all 4'7" of her, excuse me. I love the way she looks. I love the intensity of her gaze and the clearness of her gaze. By the way, I love her wit also. I don't have time, I guess, to go into her wit. I'll just give one example, which is when the Blessed Virgin Mary spoke to her, she spoke to her in the slang of the region, the patois, which was sneered at, of course, by educated French people. So when Bernadette appeared before the bishop and told him about I think it was the bishop, it might have been just the pastor, and told him about the apparition and that the Blessed Virgin Mary spoke to her, and that she spoke to her in patois, in the slang, or actually it's worse than slang, it's a local dialect. The bishop said, "You expect me to believe that the Blessed Virgin Mary knows that low-class, local peasant dialect?" And Bernadette's answer was, "Of course she knows it. How could we know it if she doesn't know it?" Anyway, she was full of stuff like that. That's Bernadette. Anyway, here's Bernadette now. I think, again, most of you know that her body's incorrupt. She was buried in 1858, and she was dug up in, I think the first time was 1919, and she was incorrupt. They made a mistake. They washed her. They washed her, and then they reburied her. And then when they dug her up again in 1925 to get relics, it turned out that washing her was not a good idea, and some decomposition happened in those intervening 6 years because of the washing. But in 1919, she was beautiful. There's a wax film over her face to give the color. When she was buried after the washing, when they dug her up again, there was damage and discoloration. She's still essentially incorrupt. Now, that's how she appears in the convent at Nevers, because she lived out her life as a sister of Nevers. I'll get back to my picture, so to speak. Okay. Okay, so she lived her, out her life, her short life. She died at 35 in the convent at Nevers. She was buried there, 1858. She was dug up and, can I say, put on display? She was dug up in 1925. I think it was to get relics associated with her beatification or her canonization. After that, she was remained in the chapel there in that glass casket. That's the glass casket again. I was there. I was staying at the convent. You could stay there as a retreatant, you know. So I had a room in the convent itself. So I could go down to the chapel anytime I wanted in the middle of the night, in the early morning, because I was locked in. And of course, the entire convent was locked to the outside world. So during the day, there are tour buses. There are lots of people. There's lots of commotion. But I could go down there at whatever, 6 in the morning, and be all alone and pray. So here's the story. I had damaged my knees badly, between downhill skiing and ballet dancing. I had a checkered past. And I had stretched out the ligaments that hold the kneecaps in place, because I faked turnout in ballet, if any of you know about ballet. And also the bump skiing didn't help. I was a very aggressive skier. So my kneecaps floated. They were loose. I couldn't bend my knees more than 90 degrees. I couldn't walk more than a few minutes without pain. I couldn't sit cross-legged. I couldn't, I could walk up a staircase, but I couldn't walk over rocks or anything. You know, I couldn't make a stretch with my legs or anything. Anyway, so it was pretty upsetting. I was at Lourdes. I was at Nevers. I had gone to Lourdes, but at this point I was at Nevers. I was staying in the convent. I go down to the chapel one morning, early morning, to pray. And I guess I'm inspired, and I just pray, Lord, if there's anything you want me to give up that's standing in the way of my path with you, just let me know and I'll give it up. This was after my conversion, needless to say. And I felt like the answer was skiing and ballet. It wasn't much to give up, because actually I couldn't ski or do ballet at that point because of the state of my knees. But I kind of hoped, I imagined that physical therapy or something might, you know, get some ability back. But anyway, I said, okay, if that's what you want, I promise I'll never go skiing again. I'll never go to another ballet class again. Then I go to the front of the chapel and I go down on my knees in front of Saint Bernadette. And I feel like a crack in my knees, like when you crack knuckles, you know, like I feel this sudden jerk in each knee. I don't remember whether I actually hear a crack or not, but I felt a crack in each knee, and I got up and my knees were fine. And they've been fine ever since, except when I think about maybe I can go skiing again, then they start to hurt, just to remind me. It's a true story. I'm not even asking you to believe me, but I want to give you the opportunity to believe me if you wish to believe me. True story. Oh, just a little cute little postscript. So I'm back home. My father at the time was about 85. He was due for a double knee replacement. He was old. I mean, his knees were in bad shape. I tell him, he's so anti-Catholic. He's so opposed to my conversion. He knows about my conversion at this point, but it's the worst thing in the world. You know, it's a total disaster, World War III, if it ever comes up. But I tell him about my knees working again, and I tell him about what happened, that I went to Nevers and they were healed. And what's he say? He says, when can we go? When can we go? It's like no atheist in a foxhole. You know, his agony from his knees were enough for him to make a joke about wanting to go and getting his knees healed. Later, by the way, I don't think I was aware of it at the time. I turned out that Bernadette died from tuberculosis of the knees. She had tuberculosis in her knees, or in one knee, which was extremely, extremely painful. So it might actually be that she has a charism having to do with healing of the knees. In case any of you have a problem with your knees that you want healed, you might want to pray to Bernadette. Anyway, that's it. Out of time, out of energy, out of sensible things to say. Thank you for watching. Thank you very, very much for watching. This is the high point of my week when I get to do these shows. Keep your eye on the channel. Subscribe to the channel and ask for notifications. You'll be notified of my next show. Subscribe to the Salvationist from the Jews Facebook page and you'll be notified. Subscribe to my Twitter feed and you'll be notified. Leave comments and I read them, much more than I respond, but I do respond. Watch my next show if you're so inclined. Pray for me if you're so inclined. And thank you for watching. And I don't know for sure when my next show will be. I hope it'll be in a few days. It's never more than about 5 days. I think I will go back to the grotto, just so that we can have the Lourdes hymn for a few minutes before I go back to the real closeout screen. So here we go. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Amen.